huge, you know, mountains of debt, but it's not a systemic issue that worries us.
Okay.
The systemic issue is, of course, the question of you know, liquidity for NBFCs, many of which have lent to real estate and where sales velocity has fallen off the cliff for a particular price point and higher, but even now increasingly in the lower price points, and it's in the lower price points, the sub 50 lakh rupee homes, where sales velocity increasing will be a much better indicator of whether things can improve in the NBFC sector.
Okay, the market is very volatile. That gap up is now getting sold into a bit, little bit. Nifty's gains are only 21 points. The Bank Nifty also, after 300 point gains, is down to 160. Still gains, of course, but let's see. Tata Motors, of course, is the big gainer. That has you know, sort of dual benefit if trade deal happens, and also this talk of a fresh negotiation on Brexit. So that's helping Tata Motors. But Dipen, good morning.
Good morning.
One interesting aspect of market over the last 1 week was this US FDA action again on some of the Indian large cap pharma names. And again, we've started to see big decline in names like Aurobindo Pharma.
Right.
Are you a buyer here?
So we've seen it in the financials, which have some of which are arguably not so well managed. Mm-hmm. That just because something's fallen doesn't mean it can't fall more, mm-hmm. or that it can't fall again. And if there is a systemic breakdown, if there's a breakdown in faith, if there's a breakdown in trust, if you guys are not playing the game by the rules. So look at financials, look at pharma. There are stringent rules in all these sectors, right? Mm-hmm. I'm trying to take a broader abstract picture here. And the fear is, the prices are telling you that investors fear that there is again, you know, misbehavior on a large scale or non-compliance. Let's look at the milder word for it, on a larger scale than what we might have thought. Otherwise, the pharma index being at I don't know how many years low and multiples, some of them actually looking at, you know, single digit for some companies, low teens for some others. And it's, what have you, it's supposed to be a knowledge sector. It's supposed to be a sector where we've beaten the rest of the world hollow for some time. And then if this is the kind of, you know, malfeasance that is alleged to be happening with respect to compliance in a compliance heavy sector, in a highly regulated sector, then there is certainly loss of faith. That's a broad brush picture.
Okay.
Of course, a lot of these companies have pulled back from these setbacks in the past, and there's no reason why they can't do it again.
I just want to point out that Tata Motors is now up over 4%, and it's actually been rallying ever since it posted its China sales last week, and it's been the third consecutive month of a double-digit growth in the Chinese market for Tata Motors particularly. So look at that. That's just flying away over there. But Dipen, good morning. I was going through your note, and very interesting in that you said that you've downgraded your multiples on TCS from 24 times to 20 times 1 year forward. It's already underperformed Infosys quite a bit this year.
Right.
You think that underperformance will continue? And between TCS and Infosys now, how do you position yourself?
Yeah, you're not leaving me with much of a choice, Sonia, because we've now got neutrals on both of these leaders.
Oh.
And we are disappointed with TCS because we've been thumping the table for a while on them, believing in their superior growth trajectory. And it was only a matter of time before that growth should have come back, but it hasn't. And the slowdown in headline growth from, you know, the 13-14% level to 8-9 kind of number looks actually, I hate using the word sustainable. So this is sticky, you know, I don't think TCS is going to get back to 12-13% growth in a hurry, is the sense we are getting. That's the vibe we got from the company on the con call. And then if that is the case, then the 24x looks rich. Okay, so which is why we've downgraded them from 24x to 20x, and it's the downgrade in the multiple more than the tweaking around with minor tweaks
in the
earnings.
What about Infosys? Did you upgrade the multiple there?
No, we didn't. Infosys, we are still at 18x, and look at that big, you know, gap that was there, and we still have a neutral on Infosys. We do like the fact, and we had a buy for the longest time on the stock, but I think much of the improvement in the growth trajectory is baked in the price, and that margin uptick that you saw has got everybody excited. They are at 21.7% EBIT margin this quarter, and people are suspecting that the margin sacrifice is over for growth. We have a slightly different perspective here. We believe that the pricing environment is not exciting. Many of their large wins are essentially renewals, which means there would be pricing pressure there as well. It's a great company. They're doing all the right things. There's no denying the fact. And both these companies are paying out anywhere between 80 to 100% of FCF. They're both at 2.5% kind of percent dividend yields. But the growth numbers are simply not exciting enough for us to thump the table on valuations.
Okay.
You know,
fair
that's
enough.
The thing.
Fair enough.
If I may complete the point, sorry. On frontline IT, the only buy that we have right now is, guess what, HCL Tech. Mm. 13-14x 1 year out numbers, and a whole lot of money reinvested, more than $2 billion reinvested over the last year into inorganic acquisitions. Perhaps the only IT services, Indian IT services company reinvesting this much money. I hope all of that pays off. Right now, the debate is open.
Okay. There's a bit of a distress factor with IndusInd Bank,
right.
Deepin. Is that giving a buying opportunity? You think the market's fearing something, and who knows, perhaps the derating may continue.
Yes, so the easiest and reckless thing to say is there a hole in IndusInd? Mm. You know, they declared that 3,000 odd crore exposure to the ILFS group a couple of quarters ago, and they took huge write-offs. Comparable growth, if I can call it that, after the Bharat financial inclusion, shall I say, into the numbers, is down now to 13% from the mid-20s, as it used to be. We were used to an IndusInd that was galloping, if not, running away.
No points, brownie points for being at 20 to 25 at a time when the economy is slowing. Prudence, isn't it?
Well, there are very, very respectable exceptions to that claim of yours. There are financial services companies which continue to grow in their defined bracket of 15 to 20%. Mm-hmm. The Bajaj Finances of the world are growing even faster. My own parent bank is another example. And while, you know, we don't have recommendations on the last two stocks that I mentioned, the point is there is a way to grow. And at 2 lakh crores loan book, with so many PSU banks withdrawing, as it were, from the market, no matter that they've got a recap right now, I don't think it's a big ask to grow. The question that investors are asking is, have you suddenly turned cautious on your lending because you're afraid that the lending you're doing is not good enough? And that's the question we need to ask. That SME2 bump up, I think there's a very creditable reduction in the stressed exposures from 1.8 to 1.1% or something. I don't know which of these stressed parties has actually paid them money back and how they managed to get it back, but I think it's very creditable.
Okay. By the way, Dipen, just hold on to that, because the market is selling off into the early morning rally. The Sensex, in fact, has gone into the red right now. The pressure, of course, was coming from Infosys, but now on TCS as well. And a lot of the banks have started to showcase
banks
pressure.
Banks have sold suddenly.
Kotak, HDFC, all of them down about 0.5%. So as you were saying, you know, this rally is not sustainable.
Can't extrapolate this market. You know, that's the problem. This is a range market.
Yeah.
And, it's working like a program. 11,350 you're selling, 11,250 you're buying. It's working. And, you know, if something is working in the market, people will do
latch
that.
Latch on to that.
We'll latch on to that. At some point, this trade will give way, but right now it's working. So I think at lower level, again, they would be buying. At higher level selling, we have to just get used to
that. We have to deal with the volatility.
Yes, yes.
All right. Dipen, in your notes, you do say that you're hearing good things on auto retail numbers. We're also hearing that the sentiment may have picked up, but it's not translated into numbers just yet. Would this be a good time to buy names like Maruti, M&M, etc., or would you still stay away?
Yeah, that's a dicey one, Sonia. Mm. So, we are told, and there is no data to corroborate this, that retail sales have been very good in the days leading up to Diwali, Dashera, etc. And especially on Maruti. I suspect some of that is a dead cat bounce, we couldn't get worse and so on. I think the big question which is being asked is not whether, you know, financing is going to be available or whether consumer sentiment. I think the question which is being asked for many of these auto companies is, are they aligned with the new realities of the auto market? So I can say all the good things that I want to about Hero Moto, but do they have a great 10-year view of their business where they are aligned with the electric bike market? Maruti, are they aligned with the electric vehicles or electric cars market? And can they ride their current dealer network to take advantage of that market? Mm. Will the rideshare blokes eat into incremental revenues as we see the millennial generation say, we don't want to buy cars? How are you going to overcome that hurdle? Will the rural interiors continue to deliver incremental growth for Maruti the way they have done so far? I think many of those answers are to be found in the strategic decisions and capital allocations that these managements make, as also the macro eco path that India adopts over the next 5 years. And I suspect that is also a very, very gray area. We've seen growth coming off to 5% in the latest numbers. We've seen the last IIP print also getting into negative. And I think this entire, you know, this global slowdown, the 3.5%, 4% going to 2%, Brexit, trade wars, India slowing down, it doesn't bode well for these cyclical sectors.
Fair point. Deepen, thank you very much indeed for joining us with your thoughts. The IRCTC chairman was speaking. Is he still speaking? I mean, it's okay. It was just the pre-listing speech. So we thought we could get a thing or two, but he wouldn't say anything new now. After all, they've declared everything in the IPO. So we shouldn't expect him to say anything different, but that's the listing party waiting for the bell to go. We'll get you more details on IRCTC in just a minute. But before that, we're going to continue with our discussion on stock markets. Markets have dipped a little bit into the red, Sensex and Nifty. Nifty Bank is also in danger of getting into the red any moment now, and the advance declines have now come 1:1. So it's a very, very equal tug of war between the bulls and the bears, you will have to see. Let's invite another market expert, Mahesh Nandurkar, the India strategist at CLSA, joins us now. Good morning, Mahesh. Good to have you with us. I want to start away first with something positive that we got over the weekend. This DLF sales, the Ultima project has shown a very good traction, and luxury housing was the big negative in the real estate space, and realty was the big negative in the finance space, knocking the bottom of a whole host of NBFCs. Should we take this as the first of the very big good news?
Well, so we have been positive on the real estate space, as you know, Lata. And the thing is, we have seen pretty encouraging data points, I would say, pretty much over the last 12 months. The September quarter, I'm told, has not been that great. And the positive numbers that we've been seeing you know, all through the second half of last calendar year and the first half of this calendar year has become quite weak in the September quarter. But what you seem to be indicating is that there is probably some sign of turnaround. What I would definitely say is that whether you know, the sector turns around now or in the next 3 months or 6 months, I think it's more a matter of time in my view, because the affordability is great, and my sense is there is you know, there is an appetite. So I think it's a matter of time before things begin to improve, even if you know, we don't conclude with that one news that you mentioned that things have already improved, but I think it's a matter of time.
Mahesh, good morning. Your thoughts on overall market? You know, we had that tax cut, and after that, that huge rally, and the market's given up almost half of that, but still, you know, holding on to the other half. How do you think the market overall is positioned right now?
Well, you know, I would say that the reason why the market has given up the gains post the corporate tax cut is that the economic data points continue to be negative, right? And we continue to see the data points which show that the slowdown is sharper than what it was thought to be, say, a month ago or a few months back. And that's the reason why the market has given up gains. And you can see that reflecting in the EPS upgrade as well, right? That as compared to a theoretical EPS upgrade, you know, just looking at the tax rates, should have been around, say, 7 to 8% for the Nifty. But in reality, what we've seen is that the upgrade has been limited to, say, about 3 to 4% or so, because the analysts have